I'm very excited to be here this morning and to share with you, but part of the sharing this morning, I want to do a little differently. Recently, I went to Belize to minister there, and we had a good time of fellowship in Little Belize and other places in Belize. And so this morning, we want to do a little bit of more sharing. Jason will come up and share a little bit about joining in this ministry, joining in the ministry of MMF together with us. And then Dan Peters will come and share about his experience in Belize as well, together with me for 2 weeks, and then I will come up after that. So, Jason, why don't you share?
Good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me or didn't catch Dad saying my name is Jason Friesen. I am son of Dietrich and Nettie Friesen. My wife's name is Tia, and I have a beautiful 10-month-old daughter at home named Soren. 2 years ago, Tia and I graduated from Steinbeck Bible College with our 3-year bachelor degrees, and since then we have lived here in Winkler, where I have been working at a local business. Now, many of you already know that my parents have been in full-time ministry over the past several years. This is mostly done in Low German, and they create lots of Low German music and Christian resources that are used across North and South America in churches and mission groups to present the gospel and to help people mature in their faith. Since we moved back to Canada from Belize in 2009, I have been helping them in their music performances across southern Manitoba and traveled with them to Belize and Bolivia to do Low German music. And for the last 2 years, I have been helping them as well by creating most of their public relations posters, event posters, CD covers, brochures, and also recording in the studio with them. Now, I think we can all agree that creating resources in a language that has only been a written language for a relatively short time is a pretty serious undertaking. I have watched my parents devote countless hours, days, weeks, and months to giving something to the Low German Mennonites that they can truly understand, and through that to come to know the Lord. So a few months ago, we started talking, and now I come to let you all know that I am planning to join them in their work. I've been doing it on the side until now still, but now we're trying to get more serious about it. Some of my tasks would be help my parents perform and record music, designing posters, CD covers, book covers, and other design projects, helping them develop Low German materials such as songbooks, Sunday school materials, and creating Low German media resources like videos, podcasts, and things like that. And as well, there are always more jobs in ministry that come up that you don't know exactly what they will be when you start, but all of those things are on the table as well. As you can imagine, this kind of work does not happen for free, but Tia and I are taking the step in faith that this is God's plan and that He will provide what is needed. We are hoping that hopefully by the end of the year, I can hand in my resignation to my current workplace and start working with my parents. We don't know yet if this will be a part-time or a full-time position. That depends quite a bit on funding and other variables as well. There are many things still up in the air. We don't have funding in place. If I start half-time, I need to find another half-time job somewhere, and we also don't know when exactly this will start, and with the whole quarantine happening now and the self-isolation, it might throw a wrench in. We're not sure yet with having to start a bit later than planned, but that's all still not set in stone. So I ask for your prayers as we begin to put this all together. Please pray that all the unknowns will become known and that His will would be revealed. Please pray that the money could come together and turn this thought into reality. Honestly, there is more to do for my parents than they can ever finish. And having helped them in the past and growing up with them in this ministry, I believe I can not only help them in their load, but also contribute to presenting the gospel and other Christian material to the Low German Mennonites. Thanks for letting me share. And once we can meet together in person again, I would be happy to answer any questions you have. Also, you can call me. I'll try to answer my phone. And also my email. If you have it, then you can use that as well. Thanks.
Thank you, Jason. Exciting what's happening in your life. We will pray. I want to talk to you guys a little bit this morning about a virus. Want to hear more news about a virus? Well, I was in Belize some time ago, and I noticed that there was a virus there. And it was a spiritual virus of deception and manipulation. But I got to start at the beginning of this story before I get to that. One Sunday, Dietrich Friesen was preaching and told the testimony of a new Christian in Belize. That's in Little Belize, a Mennonite colony. And that testimony, it gripped my heart. At the end of the service, Dietrich invited volunteers to join him on his next trip to Little Belize. I volunteered. Dietrich and Eddie came over to my house and brought me Plautdietsch material to study from. Dietrich asked, "Can you preach in Plautdietsch?" And I said, "Well, I can speak in Plautdietsch, and if the good Lord gives me the words, then I can." I had 3 weeks to learn Plautdietsch, preach in Plautdietsch, sing in Plautdietsch before I left for Belize. And I was truly amazed at how the Holy Spirit came alongside and he taught me, and how quickly I learned and how I understood. I noticed after a short time of studying the scriptures in Plautdietsch that sometimes my heart would begin to beat faster and a lump would come up in my throat and tears would well up in my eyes. And that was because I was beginning to understand scripture in a language that was not fluent to me, and yet it was my mother tongue. It was the only language I knew until I was 6 years old. That experience was extra special, and it confirmed my decision to go to Little Belize and help Dietrich. And I did speak, I did read, preach, and pray, and sing in Plautdietsch for the folks in Little Belize. But mostly I loved the people, and I was their friend and their encourager. In Little Belize, Dietrich and I, they called us affectionately, they called us Paul and Silas. And I think they called Dietrich Paul because he had a thorn in the flesh. Not so much like Paul did, but he had a blown out knee and he was on crutches the whole time. And I was Silas because I was helping him with everything. So when I arrived in Belize, in some ways it seemed as if time had stood still and I was back in history, back in the 1920s. I saw horse-drawn buggies traveling slowly on the poorest, roughest roads that I had ever seen. I saw people walking everywhere they needed to go under the sweltering Belizean sun, dressed in dark dresses, black pants, overalls, and large hats. There were no street lights to light up the streets at night, so you couldn't see the pedestrians or the horse vehicles till they're right in front of you. And there was lots of traffic after the sun went down. One good thing about the rough roads, it forced us to drive very slowly. In some other ways, life was just as modern there as it is here. Many homes had electricity via solar panels and batteries. I saw Ford International, John Deere tractors, Case IH combines, Caterpillar dozers, and huge excavators. Except that these machines, they all had tracks or steel wheels. I learned that the roads are not maintained for a good reason, because it forces everyone to go slowly. The old colony system is a system that dictates salvation by works. It dictates salvation by self-humiliation and difficult living. And if you don't humiliate yourself, the preachers and the bishop will do it for you in a public meeting. Let's say if you bought a tractor and it had rubber tires on it, you didn't take them off right away, or a combine, and you went out to the field with it, they would make sure you brought that combine back right swift and park it in your shop or in your yard and leave it there until you change it over to steel wheels, and they'd make sure they shame you in public. This system claims that they must slow down their lifestyle, and rough roads adds an element of difficulty, which in turn is seen as suffering in this world, and that will credit their holiness account. See, according to their laws for salvation, for many years prior, they could only use horses and oxen to do the field work. But their salvation has relented on the rules, and they have adopted modern tractors and machinery. But the rubber tires have to go. They have to be removed. Because the rubber tires, you know, would create an opportunity for them to go too fast and be too comfortable. And according to their laws, it is sin to have rubber tires. Cabs are removed from tractors and combines to create an element of discomfort for the operator. Again, adding to the holiness account. And here, friends, is what I got to tell you, the piece that broke my heart. This is where I see the virus. This piece breaks my heart in so many pieces. Their entire lifestyle, social, economical, and spiritual lifestyle is dictated by the preachers and the bishop and forced by manipulation and deception. I heard the testimonies, many testimonies of the new Christians that are there in Little Belize. And this is how they tell the story. The preachers read the High German Bible in church, which we don't understand. None of the people understand, and the preachers don't understand. They themselves do not understand what they are reading. They don't understand the language. But they expound upon it anyway in Plautdeutsch. And the deception is that the explanations, they do not conform to the scriptures. Their explanations are only old colony rules and traditions. And for years, this manipulation has worked. They made the people believe that all these rules were in the Bible. And if they didn't want to go to hell, they better obey all these rules and all these laws. And the heartbreaking thing is, the people, they believed it. Because they could not understand the language. It makes me wonder how many of our Mennonites, with names like Peters and Fries and Hildebrand, Rempel, all the Mennonite names, all those people have gone to a Christless eternity because of this virus. But here is good news. But God in his wisdom has used MMF, what Jason just talked about, and modern technology to bring the gospel into Little Belize. A lot of the old colony people, they secretly have cell phones and access to the internet. Now they listen to Christian radio, they hear the true gospel being preached in Plautdeutsch by evangelical pastors, they hear Christian music, they can read Bibles in Plautdeutsch on the internet. And through DeFriesen's ministry, they now have access to Plautdeutsch Sunday school material in their church, devotional books, and hymn books to sing from in their own Plautdeutsch language. When these folks hear the gospel in their own language, they understand God's word, and their hearts open up so wide and their eyes even wider, and they accept Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And they're free. They're set free from the bondage. I could tell you a lot of different stories here today. We just don't have time, and I'd love to sometime do that, because there's testimony after testimony after testimony of how God has set people free and how they just will not go back to the old system because Jesus wasn't part of that system. The mission church where we were working from is called Scheinfeld Mennonite Church. It is the members of the Utgeschloten. Utgeschloten is a Plautdeutsch word. We call it excommunication, but Utgeschloten has a much deeper meaning than that. The ministers, the pastors, believe that they have the keys to heaven, and they have the authority to lock someone out of heaven. So that word, Utgeschloten, goes much deeper than excommunication in my way of thinking. It is a place, this church is a place where the new Christians meet. Most of the testimonies I heard had one thing in common for their excommunication. And that one thing was, I have accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And then they were excommunicated from the church. But not just from the church. Also from heaven. Like I said, the preachers claim that they have the keys to lock and unlock heaven's doors, preventing whom they choose not to enter. Plus, they can no longer participate in the social and economics of the colony as well. They can no longer buy or sell anything on the colony. They can't go to their families or their friends or for visits, and they can't come back to you anymore either. So they're isolated. So they build their own family in the church, in the new evangelical church at Scheinfeld. The new believers at Belize have adopted two biblical principles that I saw that was going on, and they're using these principles to witness to the unsaved on the colony. The first principle is that they will not retaliate against the old colony. Instead, every opportunity they get, they show love and friendship. They are being Romans 12 Christians. Romans 12, verse 18 says, if it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with one another. Do not take revenge, my dear brothers, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. And the second principle that I saw at work at that new church is that they want to be a light in the darkness. The colony is spiritually very dark. And it is really exciting to see what a huge difference it makes from a few new Christians, how that's lighting up in that darkness, in that colony. Matthew 5, verse 15 and 16 says, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. And now we're going to do something in this service that's going to be benefiting people in Little Belize, because we got people tuned in via the internet listening to this service. And when Diedrich and I were in Little Belize, we got no opportunity to prepare praise and worship because the people just called it the songs from the congregation. And like I said, I only had 3 weeks to learn. Diedrich and I are going to sing a Low German song for you this morning. It is a very well-known Southern gospel song called Yes, I Know, but we're going to do it in Plautdeutsch. And again, we didn't practice because, you know, social distancing kept us apart this week. So Jason's going to come help us on the bass. Let's try to do this, boys.
Thank you, Dan. Yes, we want to share this one song. We sang this several times in Little Belize. People love this song because the message is so awesome that Jesus' blood can set you free. Jorot Asso.
Jesus' blood don't wash the oysters in the rain.
Yes, we did a lot of singing like that in Little Belize. And it's like Dan said, you walk up and then you give them the opportunity and they just keep shouting and keep shouting till our time is up. And then you just say, sorry, that's as much as we can do today. And then we switch gears. The harvest is plentiful. Therefore, go and make disciples. Wherever you are tuning in today, you might wonder about this heading, go and make disciples. We're all in quarantine. We're stuck at home. How can we go make disciples? This is a beautiful time, actually, when you think of it. We're stuck at home. We have way more time on our hands to do different stuff than we normally do. So why not get into the Word, dig deeper, study to show ourselves approved unto God, and get ready to go and make disciples. On December 29th of last year, I preached a message here. Dan talked about it briefly, about how the light is among us. The light is in us for those of us who believe. If you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then according to Jesus, Matthew 5:16, we are the light of the world. I also told you about a family who lived in a certain colony in Belize, where Dan and I spent a couple of weeks together. And they had a lot of trouble with their colony friends and neighbors because they became Christians. This family was living by different standards now that they knew Jesus and they could start reading his word. And that caused a lot of problems for them. And I called him John to protect his identity. I also shared in this message that John and I had gone to Belize City, to the ombudsman, to the lawyer who had heard about him and the trouble he was causing on the colony. And so he wanted to hear John's side of the story personally. The lawyer told us that perhaps Jesus had planted John right where he wanted him as a light to the rest of the people there because it was so very dark. He encouraged John to stay as long as he could endure it and be the light for those people in that colony. In January of this year, I went to Belize to spend 4 weeks in ministry there, most of it on this colony where John and his family still live today. We met with him several times. Dan Peters joined me there, and we did a lot of ministry for 2 weeks while he was there. We did a lot of visitation, singing, sharing, preaching, and so on. It was really good to be there to connect again with those people, with that community, and just to see how God is at work in marvelous ways. We connected with numerous people who had already received salvation through grace, through faith, and it clearly showed in their faces and in their lives that they knew Jesus. We also visited with a good number of people who were still searching for the truth. They had lots of questions. They wanted assurance of salvation. And so we had many good opportunities to visit with them. And then we also met those who just turned their backs as soon as we came close, because they knew who we were and what we were doing there. Overall, it was an amazing and wonderful time out there. It was so good to see the hunger for God's word, the hunger to know the truth. And we know, according to the words of Jesus, the truth will set us free. Jesus is the only truth that can set us free. As most of you probably know, I crushed the cartilage in my right knee on the day I arrived in Belize, right within 2 hours. So I was on crutches the whole time I was in Belize till the second last day before I left. But today I want to share with you an experience I had on the last Sunday evening that I was on this colony. By then, Dan left on Saturday. And this happened the very next Sunday. The story involves one of our dear friends there who is still in the colony system, at least sort of, still playing it safe in some ways, but definitely born again. He loves the Lord. It is very evident on his face and in his testimony that he knows Jesus personally as Lord and Savior. In fact, You can see that evidence of Jesus in the whole family. You can't hide it. When that new life settles in and your sins are forgiven, it just shows. You cannot hide it. And it's amazing how many times when we met with people, you don't have to ask them without them you asking for it. Within 5 minutes, they were telling you their testimony of how they came to know Jesus. There was just such an excitement from those who knew Jesus. This gentleman had called me earlier about the possibility of them coming over for a visit one evening yet before I left. We made arrangements for this last Sunday evening. There were two other men who heard about it and joined in right away, and they also planned to come over. They said right away, well, we will bring watermelon and rollkuchen, and then we'll come for supper, and then we'll spend the evening together. Wow, I love watermelon and rollkuchen. Oh, that is just fantastic for me. I was really, really looking forward to that evening for the food and definitely for the amazing fellowship with these friends. Finally, Sunday came. I had looked forward for a long time already. And these friends started coming. First one, then two, three, and then four. Oh, how many are coming? Then five. Five couples showed up. There were about 10 children that they brought along altogether. One of these couples, I believe I had never met before, came to our house. It's a quarter mile off the main road, and I mean the colony road. It's right up against the bush. It's surrounded by fields on both sides, and you have to drive through the field just to get to the back so no one can see you. And it was dark. And here we had five couples. It was just amazing. I was still hobbling around on my crutches and couldn't do much to help. But while the ladies were making themselves at home in the kitchen, the men carried tables and chairs and set them up and arranged and made all the preparations we needed outside. One of them even had to make a quick trip back home because we didn't have nearly enough dishes in the mission house. We only had a setting for four. And all of a sudden, we were way more people than four. So they went home and got from their own dishes so that we could have this evening together. Boy, oh boy, did they put on a feast. It was marvelous. It was so much fun. They brought watermelon, rollkuchen. For those of you who know what I'm talking about, they bought disco meat. Meat prepared in a plow disc with all the works and trimmings. And they brought onion soup. It was so delicious. Escabeche, as some of you would call it. It was really, really good. But the fellowship was even sweeter. The fellowship was just marvelously sweet. We visited for several hours about anything and everything. They asked numerous questions about faith and salvation and life. We had a very, very good time of fellowship. During our visit, I asked the men if they could give me an idea as to how many, maybe a percentage, of the people on the colony would be ready for change, would be searching for something else, something new. How many of them would want the assurance of salvation? How many would be open or appreciate a visit from someone like me to come and talk about these things and help them through those issues? And based on what they told me and the conversations that we've had over the years and in the last 4 weeks that I was there, my understanding is that the majority of those colony people are tired of their way of life and they're searching for something new and better. Most of the people want change. They want to know that they can be born again, that there is assurance of salvation. We're talking about a colony of about 3,000, just over 3,000 people. And if you talk about the majority of 3,000 or just over 3,000 people, that means about 2,000 people of those, or even more, are ready for change. About 2,000 people on that colony long for the assurance of salvation. They are hungry for the truth, and only the truth can set them free. The harvest truly is plentiful, and the laborers are few. But this is only one colony that I've talked about so far. What about the other colonies with similar statistics in Belize? What about the colonies of Mexico or Paraguay, Bolivia, Peru, Argentina, Colombia, and the list goes on and on and on. The harvest is huge. It is so huge. Just with the Low German colony Mennonites alone. Never mind all the other cultural and religious groups scattered across the globe. The harvest is huge, and it desperately needs to be brought in. We had so much fun there that Sunday evening till one of the ladies asked if we were aware that it was already after 10 o'clock in the evening. Oh, we had lost track of time. No, we had not noticed. Very quickly, everyone just jumped up and cleaned up and packed up and gone they were. Our scripture text for this morning, thank you, Dave, for reading Matthew 9, 35 to 38, and also Matthew 28, 18 to 20. Jesus is talking in these fields, In these verses, Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues. And then skipping down a few verses or a few words, when he saw the crowds, how many people were hungry for the truth, were hungry to know that they could be born again, hungry to know that there is life, there's purpose, and there's meaning in life. When Jesus saw the people, he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were helpless. They were harassed. They were like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to the disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." And I'm wondering today, with this virus, with all this isolation that we have to practice these days, we have lots of time to read God's word, to let it go deep, to sink in. I'm wondering, do we have time? Lots of time to pray the Lord of the harvest exactly the way Jesus says it here, that he will send out workers into the harvest field. The day will come very soon when we'll all be out and open and around again just like normal. The virus will be gone. But what will we have done with our time now? Will we be ready to go out into the harvest field when we have the freedom to do so? Matthew 28, 18 to 20. Then Jesus came and said to them, to his disciples, to you and me, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." I was humbled and blessed and amazed at the hunger that these people have for the Word of God. They are so eager to know the truth because so many of them are terrified of death. Met this one couple. They just came unexpectedly to a different place where I was invited to for supper. And eventually, when all the other company had left, they came in and they said, "It was so dark at home, we just had to go somewhere else and focus on something else." So many of them have no hope, no life, but they desperately desire it. It reminds me of what the prophet Amos was talking about in Amos chapter 1, verse 11. Where God says, "I will send a famine through the land, not a famine of food or a thirst for water, but a famine of hearing the words of the Lord." The Old Testament prophet Amos prophesied about a time of hunger that people would have to hear the words of God. He described a people searching desperately for direction but unable to find it. And some people would even faint as a result. I see that kind of hunger in the colonies, wherever we go. And when I look at our dear, dear people, our brothers, our sisters in the colonies, our Frinchaf, uncles and aunts, probably your relatives too, so many are looking for purpose, for meaning to life. They have a hunger for the Word of God. They want to know the truth. We all hope that we do not have to experience such physical hunger that it would make us fear for survival. But in our world today, with all that is going on with this virus and our isolation, who knows what is still to come? Nothing is guaranteed here in this life, except that it will end one day and we'll stand before God. When it boils down to the very core, all that is left is Jesus and our personal relationship with Him. Everything else is just fiction, like they said in the Top Cops show years ago. Who knows what all the future holds? But of course, we have nothing to worry about, since we know who holds the future, and we're in His hands. But I wonder, do we hunger for the word of the Lord? Like Amos talks about here, do we hunger for the word of God, the truth, the way the colony people do that we just visited? Thankfully, we have easy access to the Bible. We have numerous copies in numerous translations. We have at least four, probably five translations in our house. Way more translations, but at least four or five languages in our house that we can read. So when we're hungry for God, for the truth, we can sit down anytime and we can read it in a language that we know, we understand. And then we can satisfy our deepest longings. But what about those who don't have the Bible in a language they can understand? Many of these colony people are in that situation. Like Dan said in his sharing, many of them have the Word of God in High German, but they have no clue what it says. Nettie says it's just like when she reads Spanish. She can read all the words and pronounce them perfectly, correctly, but she has not a clue what she's reading. That's what it is for many colony people in High German. Are you willing to bring it to them, the Word of God, in a language they can understand? Are you willing to go to these, our dear people, to bring them the truth, to bring them the word of the Lord? Are you willing, wherever you are gathered in your home, to go deep into the word, and as soon as this isolation is over, to go out into the world, bring the harvest in, starting right now with your own family, wherever you are? Are you hungry for the Lord? Are you reading and listening to what God has to say to you? The harvest is so plentiful. Jesus Himself says the harvest is plentiful, the workers are few. Are you willing to go to help bring it in? Are you willing to pray the Lord of the harvest to send out workers into His harvest field? Today, God is calling us. He's calling you. He's calling me. He says, pray and go. Pray the Lord of the harvest to send forth workers. And then He says, go, make disciples. We're involved in both of those, or should be. He's telling us, pray, and He's telling us, go. Let us be faithful today as He sends us out to His harvest field, wherever that is, whether it's your family, or across the globe in another continent, another language, who knows? Let us be faithful today. Let's pray. Father, we are privileged, indeed so very privileged, to know you personally as Lord and Savior. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross, for providing salvation by your own blood, by your own life, so that we could be saved, that we could know you, we could walk in fellowship with you. Thank you, Father, for your amazing love that saved a wretch like me. And today, as we think about this isolation that we're involved in, this quarantine where we have to stay apart and stay separate from others, Father, I pray that you will grant us the grace and the determination and the willpower to go deep into your word, to spend lots of time in your word, to know the truth so that we can pass it on to others. And then I pray, Father, that you will grant us the grace to pray that you will send out workers. We pray right now, Father, would you stir up an army of Christians across the globe? Would you touch every heart and cause such a great awakening that the whole world will stand at attention and see that this is you, Lord, that they will know that you are God Almighty. Father, I pray that you will stir in us a passion to love you more, to love our neighbors more, and to faithfully go into the harvest field to bring the harvest in. Touch us today. Draw us today, Lord, we pray. And send us wherever you wish, till the whole world knows you as Lord and Savior. We thank you for such a privilege through Jesus Christ. Amen.